My name is Paula Weitzman. Today's date is September the 6th, 1996. I will be conducting an interview in English in Montreal, Canada, with Mr. Philip Katz. Can you please tell me your name and spell it?
My name is Philip E. Katz, P-H-I-L-I-P-E. K-A-T-Z.
And the E stands for?
Ephraim.
And that is spelled?
E-P-H-R-A-I-M.
What was your name at birth?
My name was Philip, F-U umlaut, L-O umlaut P.
Philip, and the family name?
Katz.
Did you ever have any other names?
No.
No nicknames?
Well, actually, I shouldn't say that because there was a period of time in the United States when, for a funny reason, I was known as Mr. Philippe because there was another man by the name of Franz Joseph Katz in the same office that I was at who preceded me. And so it was decided to avoid confusion that I would be called Mr. Ephraim Philip until the man, Franz Joseph Katz, was transferred and I could recover my name.
During the years from 1939 to 1945, you were known as?
I was known as Philip Katz. And familiarly with most people in my town, known as Fischu, which was a kind of a distortion of my Yiddish name, which was Fischu.
Your date of birth?
March 1st, 1924.
Where were you born?
I was born in Kisvarda, K-I-S-V-A-R-D-A. In Hungary. It was for Hungary, a medium-sized town of about 18 to 20,000, and served as an administrative and market center in the county of Szabolcs, S-A-B-A-B-O-L-C-S.
Do you recall your address in Kisvarda?
Yes, I do. It was 7-9 Saint Laszlo, Street, which was the main street in Kisvarda, and our home was located virtually dead center in the city.
Can you describe Kisvarda for me and the Jewish life that existed there?
That's easier said than done. Kisvarda, as I said, had about 18 to 20,000 population, and the Jewish population constituted almost one-third of the population of the town. It was one of those relatively few towns in Hungary where the Jewish population, other than in Budapest, where of course over a quarter of the population was Jewish, where there was such a heavy concentration of Jewish population, and where the impact of the Jewish community was as substantial as it was in Kisvarda. Almost all of commerce, professions, banking, what little manufacturing there was. And other than the schools, I would say all of cultural life, including the lending libraries, which is the only kind of libraries that there were in town. There were no public libraries. Were completely Jewishly dominated. the Jewish community itself was a very interesting and composite community. It was entirely Orthodox, but of course the actual population, Jewish population, wasn't Orthodox by any means. There were both various shadings of observance as well as various shadings of assimilation, various degrees of assimilation. But formally the community was Orthodox, and as a matter of fact, I would say that the community was by and large dominated by the fundamentalist or the extreme Orthodox, mostly Hasidic community. In its public behavior, the community had to conform to the positions, basically, or observance, basically prescribed by the ultra-Orthodox. I don't know for sure whether or not numerically they also constituted the majority, although it could have been, because it is usual in with Orthodox communities, their birth rate, of course, was much higher than that of the non-Orthodox or non-observant or assimilated Jews. So it is quite possible that that they constituted the majority. But what is most significant is that that they dominated the coloration of the community. The community in Kishwada was very much like any other Orthodox Hungarian community in terms of its organizations and institutions. There was a council which was by and large representative of all shades of opinion. They were elected. The community was officially recognized, and the government power was available to collect what was known as the Kultus tax, which is the official tax that that everyone had to pay to a religious community, whether Christian or Jewish. This was by and large, I think, true of all Central European countries. Certainly after the Enlightenment. Out of these taxes, the community, of course, maintained a variety of institutions, starting from the kosher slaughtering of animals and fowl to the rabbis, the cantors, the ritual bath. There was a very large Jewish public school, which I believe went up to either 6 or 8 grades. I think maybe 8 grades. The school, of course, had to have a core curriculum conforming to the the government-prescribed curriculum. There was relatively little Jewish studies at this school. Jewish studies were to be acquired in the religious schools, the cheders and the Talmud Torah and the yeshiva, which also functioned from time to time, not always, dependent on who the rabbi was. There were in the city, I would say, at least 24 permanent functioning synagogues. There were the major three synagogues, the central synagogue, which was a very large and quite beautiful edifice, built probably in the late 20s, maybe even the early 30s. Must have been the late 20s, which was really the representative institution of the community. Right next to it, there was another smaller synagogue known as the Bet HaMidrash, which was the home and center and prayer house of what is normally called Amcha, the less observant, less learned, less knowledgeable, but still quite orthodox elements of the community. The central synagogue was supposedly the home of the more advanced, more enlightened, less orthodox elements in the community. And then there was a major Hasidic synagogue known as the Klaus, which was a kind of a catch-all institution where frequently conflicting Hasidic groups congregated. Frequently in the Klaus and around the Klaus, there were quite virulent debates and even, I would say, physical altercations because of the conflicts between the various courts of various rabbis. And then there were a very large number of smaller synagogues, usually attached to the home of one of the Hasidic rabbis in town, who may have been a descendant of very well-known wonder rabbis, but of lesser stature than their predecessors, but who have had their own adherents who congregated in those synagogues. And then there were any number of smaller synagogues you maintained by some private people with means who lived perhaps a little too far out so that they could not come during the Sabbath or holidays easily by foot and return home to any one of the other synagogues, or who for a variety of personal needs and conveniences felt that they had to have a prayer house literally in their house or very near to it. The educational system that really should be called the Jewish system was a kind of a four-tiered system where you had the cheders, which youngsters began to attend beginning from age 3. I remember when my time came and my hair was cut, leaving only the pears at age 3, with the appropriate celebration, being taken to the cheder that was attached to a Moshe Klein's home, which in effect was what might be called pre-kindergarten or kindergarten, and where at age 3 you began to be taught the Hebrew alphabet and reading. And then you had various levels as you advanced in age and knowledge until you arrived for what they call the Talmud Torah, which might be called sort of the middle school. This was the earlier grades were largely private rabbis or teachers who maintained their own institutions from the fees that the students paid. The Talmud Torah was already a community institution, which I suppose was, if not assisted financially, certainly supervised by the community, and to some extent managed by the community, where you had what I could be considered regular grades, where you advance from one class to the next, dependent on your academic achievement. And I must enter here an incident that occurred to me here maybe about 5 or 6 years ago. I had gone to St. Therese to the Tusher Rebbe, who, by the way, was a classmate of mine at one point. And when I arrived there, up in the front of his synagogue, there was a man arrayed in the usual Hasidic attire for the holidays, with a shtramel and a bekicher and a long beard, fairly well whitened already. And someone came over to me and he said that that man up there wants to see me. So I went up there, and he turned to me after all that we have gone through, the Holocaust, the almost 50 years of living in the United States or in North America, and his first words out of his mouth were to me, "Tell me, when we went to the Moshe Klein's Talmud Torah, did we study this tractate of the Talmud or that?" I am mentioning this because I think it really quintessentially demonstrates the Jewish attachment to learning that is so deep-seated that after all that we have gone through, and after a separation and a discontinuity of 45, 50 years, the first word out of a man who meets a former fellow student is, "What tractate did we study?" Everything else is forgotten. Only the learning matters. Even the suffering is forgotten. And so it is understandable that culture in Hungary was so dominantly created, maintained, and managed by Jews. To return to the educational system in Kishwara, then there were, beyond the Talmud Torah, and another grade, so to say, which was considered the Yeshiva Katana, or the junior high, or perhaps junior college. These were, again, privately run institutions, if you can call them that, because usually what they were, as were the kindergarten levels also. They were a room in the home of the particular teacher who, as I say, derived his living from the teaching and from the fees that his students paid him. And then beyond that, in Kishwada, unlike in some other places, where famous rabbis maintained what permanently what were known as yeshiva, which you might call graduate schools, we had only occasionally when our local chief rabbi, I think, was ill, sort of the yeshiva petered out. But the interesting thing about this system is, as well as the life of the community and its organization and structure, is that it was all contiguous. It was all one. All of the stores on Main Street, with rarest exception, were Jewishly owned. Then if you turn to the right on Start Street, it was for at least, I would say, a mile, all Jewish residents and institutions. You could go on one side of Star Street and literally go in the backyards of these institutions through that mile or mile and a half and see nothing but Jewish institutions and Jewish homes. You started out at the corner with the Jewish delicatessen store and the Jewish grocery store, and then came the Bet HaMidrash, and then came the Central Synagogue, and then came the lower classes of the of the Cheder, and then came the rabbi's residence with his synagogue, and which also served as the yeshiva, and then you came to the Jewish bakery. And then you came to the mikveh, and then you came from the mikveh, you went to the clothes, and then you went to the, or in the same backyard, you had the scribes and his family, and after that you had the Jewish council's office, and you had the office of the beadles, who, by the way, were also collecting the taxes. It's very interesting, the system. Or it's quite interesting. I don't know whether it's really familiar in North America at all, or to North Americans, because it has never existed in North America. You were assessed a tax. And you could, in effect, elect to pay the tax, either in installments or in one fell swoop. But by and large, most people would pay their tax by going to the beadle's home, who had a little window, like a teller's window, and you would buy a ticket to have your chicken slaughtered.
Go ahead.
I have to stop.
No.
Go ahead. And that ticket not only permitted you to have your chicken slaughtered, but at the same time constituted a payment towards your taxes. And so in the backyard, almost next to the clothes, there was the slaughterhouse for the chicken. And next to it was the concierge, the one non-Jew around, who was responsible for cleaning the slaughterhouse and the synagogues and putting the lights on and off on Sabbaths and holidays. He and his family lived there, and they were virtually the only non-Jews for a mile and a half around. And then you had some of the ritual slaughterers were living there, and then next to it, next to the Beatles, there was a home of the deputy rabbi, Dayan. Below his building were the butcher shops. The butchering of animals was under the supervision of the community. The community provided the mashgiach, who was, of course, paid for by the community, but again, it was paid out of the income paid by the butchers for the slaughtering of the animals.
Philip, we're going to take a break now,
sure,
and we'll continue in a moment. Thank you. Interviewing Mr. Philip Katz. Philip, you were telling me about the town of your birth, Kisvarda, in Hungary. Can you continue, please?
Yes, sure. As I have told you, Star Street, which branched off from the center of town at Main Street, was for a long stretch, almost completely Jewish. And perhaps I can give you an indication of an interesting element of the economy of the Jewish community. On the other side of Star Street, the first building was an apothecary, of course owned by Jews, because the apothecary, the chemist, as they would be called then, of course, was a professional, and therefore he was a Jew. With the rarest exception, so were all the doctors and lawyers. And then next to it you would have, for instance, the Beadle living across the street from the main synagogue, which was known as the Shul, and he was, so to say, the custodian of the main Shul. The Jewish community itself, it was almost a kind of a closed economy where the community, to serve its religious and communal needs, in effect was a very substantial employer, and where employment almost created a kind of a dynasty. If you were the beadle of the shul, then you eventually had your son or son-in-law take over for you. If you were a shochet or a ritual slaughterer, as for instance was at a mechel in our town, when you married off one of your daughters to a gimple, or maybe it was a mechel who was the son-in-law, and a gimple was the father-in-law, I don't know exactly at this point, then in effect your dowry for your daughter was your becoming also a ritual slaughterer in town. And if you were the one who maintained the mikveh, then your son-in-law or your son eventually took over that position. Some of these people would have either several functions or have trades or businesses besides. For instance, the beadle of the shul, a certain Mr. Hirsch, at one time was a broom maker. He had a factory for making brooms. The factory, of course, consisted of himself, his children, with a few pieces of equipment, and they made all the brooms for the whole town. At another time, I think it was the same Mr. Hirsch or somebody else, for instance, had a dairy plant. I don't even know whether or not it can be dignified with the term plant, but again, there were a few pieces of equipment which he used to separate milk and make butter and sour milk and things of that kind. And then, you know, you would go down the street and even, for instance, what moving there was. Of course, moving was done by a big cart with some of these heavy horses that you occasionally see on old beer ads. That was also Jewishly owned. And although the owner may have been a Jewishly unlettered, he was an Orthodox or a member of an Orthodox community. The hardware store, the letter store, there were tradesmen who, certainly in the eyes of the more Hasidic and Talmudically better trained Jews, were looked down on as the Amhoratzim, the plain folk. Nonetheless, were members of an Orthodox Jewish community, and observed the rituals and the holidays, and sometimes were quite self-possessed members of the synagogues and the various institutions. You could actually say that there was hardly any profession or any trade in which Jews did not participate and which were not part of this closed economy. I mean, there was a Jewish barbershop, or several of them. I mean, I don't think that you could go to a non-Jewish barbershop. I don't even know whether that was in existence. Or a corsetier. It was all Jewish and Jewishly owned.
What was the language of commerce and the language of the street?
The language of commerce was and the language of the street was, of course, Hungarian. You have to know that the Hungarians were very insistent on Hungarianizing, not unlike the situation that we are familiar with here. Although quite a number of the, certainly the more ultra-Orthodox Jews, were very weak in their spoken Hungarian, and some of them had no written Hungarian at all. But by and large, of course, everybody spoke Hungarian on the streets and on the and in the stores and workshops, including these Hasidic Jews, who some of whom were merchants and who had to serve consumers and a clientele with whatever Hungarian they could manage, or they had employees who, of course, spoke Hungarian much better because, by and large, sales personnel were not the people who went to cheder or to yeshiva. So they were more, shall I say, worldly. But this dynastic and self-perpetuating and kind of self-contained economy was really one of the main characteristics of the Jewish community in Kishwada and certainly of other communities too, perhaps not to the same degree. On the other hand, it wasn't only the Jews obviously did not restrict themselves to their own community in their commerce and in their trade, so that institutions or enterprises that were of a more general nature were in Jewish hands, but served the public at large, you know, not restricted to the Jewish community in their services or the goods that they sold.
Can I take you back for a moment to the
sure.
educational system? Can you tell me what languages the children were taught in, and if girls had the same accessibility to education as the boys?
Well, in the Jewish school, of course, the teaching language was Hungarian. It was not co-educational. They had separate classes for boys and girls. And, of course, in the state schools or the state-operated schools, it was, of course, again, Hungarian was the teaching language. But for the more orthodox element, and not only the Hasidim, the spoken language of the house and the family language was usually Yiddish. You could almost judge the degree of religiosity by the language that was spoken at in the house. There were the Hasidim whose real mother tongue was Yiddish. And then as you went, so to say, up the ladder of, or down the ladder of relative religiosity, the Yiddish would sort of peter out. There would be occasional use or just a few words until you got to the assimilated who didn't know any Yiddish at all. They may have understood some of it because many of them would have had either a German education or knew German as a second language. So they would understand the Yiddish. But basically you would almost judge the degree of religiosity by the language used in the home.
You mentioned the synagogues that existed in Kishwada. Do you know if the large central synagogue is still in existence? Can you tell me something about
The structure itself is in existence. When I last visited there, maybe about 5 or 6 years ago, the fence around it, which was really part of the structure and was a rather elegant sort of fence and gate built into it, was gone. The institution, the structure itself stood. The interior apparently was virtually totally destroyed, in the sense that it was beautifully hand-painted, and of the painting there was a little bit left in the ceiling. But the synagogue itself apparently has gone through several transformations, the last being a kind of a folk it was a kind of a folkloristic exhibit and cultural house. At the time I was there, they had an exhibit of the history of Kishwada, with very large segments of it, of course, showing the history of the Jewish community, because the Jewish moment was of such importance in the history of the city. As best as I understand it, the main shul is still, at this point, some kind of a cultural institution.
When did it stop being a synagogue?
Well, it really stopped being a synagogue when the Germans invaded Hungary, and within a matter of a few weeks after that, the persecution of the Jews that was the Holocaust, not the ordinary persecution which the Jews of Hungary had to endure virtually from 1919 on. I would say that, curiously enough, I had a big hand in the cessation of the shul being a house of prayer and a house of God, because on the second day of Pesach in 1944, shortly after the Germans marched into Hungary on March 19, 1944, I believe, on that day, suddenly at the corner of Star and Main Street, where a line of carts appeared with gendarmes, who then somehow almost immediately disappeared, with Jews from the neighboring villages piled up, young and old, with a little bit of their belongings, and they were just dropped there across the street from the synagogue, from the shul, which was only the second or third building at the street, at the beginning of the street. And there they were, totally lost, obviously being uprooted suddenly and without, not only not given any preparation, but totally lost because they were given no idea of what their fate was to have been. And in our town by that time, there were very few young Jewish men around, because most of the others had been hauled away long before to the so-called labor auxiliaries of the Hungarian army, which basically meant really being cannon fodder or mine detectors for the Germans on the Eastern Front. I must have been one of maybe a dozen young Jews of my age, with the exception of perhaps some of the more Hasidic Jews who somehow managed to escape being called up to the labor auxiliary. I wasn't called up because I was registered at some other place, and then they eventually they transferred my registration to Kishwarda, and in Kishwarda by that time they weren't calling up the people because obviously we were already consigned to annihilation. But some of the other young people of my age whose registration was in some other town, particularly in Budapest, they were called up. So that, in effect, we have had no able-bodied young Jews in the city, with really exception of maybe a dozen or maybe two dozen people. And when I say able-bodied, I don't even mean people who were physically able-bodied, but who were mentally in the position and had the attitude of attempting to try to help. And so I rustled up a couple of my peers and began to try to see what we could do for these unfortunate people who were simply dropped on Star Street. And the only immediate roof that I could think of was, of course, the synagogue. And I had terrible difficulty in attempting to get the authorities there be to open the synagogue and to let us bring these people under a roof, to the point where eventually we just had to break down the doors. And then we had considerable difficulty with the reluctance of the people to desecrate the synagogue. And of course you also had difficulty with men and women being accommodated under the same roof, and how do you separate them. And then attempting to try to provide some means of hygiene. You know, there were outhouses, but they certainly weren't prepared for that kind of a massive number of people. And then the question of feeding them arose. And remember, this was Pesach. And the problems we have had, because essentially the gendarmerie, which seems to have been almost exclusively in charge of the operation, weren't very kindly disposed on the one hand, and on the other hand, the Jews of the city being completely bewildered and lost. On the one hand, were afraid to have contact with the people who were brought in, lest it have a deleterious impact on their existence. They were still in their homes, and as far as they were concerned, perhaps this transport of people that were brought in from the neighbor, from the villages, because eventually that is, those areas were going to become part of the front line, and maybe Jews were considered unreliable, but nothing is going to happen to them. And if they have too much of a contact with them, maybe it will reflect upon them. So to persuade people to give money and food and dishes and clothing was a very difficult operation for the few able-bodied, I should even say able-minded youngsters who were around this went on for days. I really don't know exactly for how long, because the operation of bringing the Jews in from the neighboring villages was just seemed almost haphazard as far as the authorities were concerned. I'm sure it wasn't, but they just brought them in and plunked them down. There were no preparations of any kind that were made for them, so that it was up to these few people, like myself, to attempt to bring some order and to try to at least prevent these people who were brought in from dying of starvation, from dying of exposure, from dying of hunger. It was a hell of a mess. You know, the next transport that came in, we went to a man by the name of Coyne, who had on Star Street a big lumber yard, and he had a huge open shed that only had a roof and no sides. And incidentally, Mr. Coyne was, I think, one of two Jews who remained in Kishwada, who was not deported because he was, I think, an American citizen. There was one other man who was allowed to stay because he was 100% a war veteran or war invalid from the First World War. And so we brought the people in there. And then to try to organize, again, the minimal hygiene, or to, within a matter of days, to persuade women, young women particularly, to cut their hair because there was an outbreak of lice right away, to try to provide enough water. You have to understand there was no hot and cold running water. And if there was an outhouse in the back of the of this lumber yard, that there were maybe 1,000 people around, and so you had to provide some other means. It was an unbelievable undertaking, which was literally unorganized and unrecognized by the Jewish community authorities in the beginning. Eventually, when our turn came, or a few days before that, the ghetto was established on Star Street, about the side, on both sides of the street where the ritual bath was, or where the Jewish community center was. I don't mean by center, center like here. What I mean is where the offices were of the council, and where the Dayan lived, and where the entrance was to the to the yard within which the shul, the clothes was, and where all of these functionaries lived. And on both sides of Star Street, to a depth of about, I would say, a block or a block and a half until the next street, they squeezed the Jews into the homes of the Jews who had lived there in normal times. And then it became somewhat more organized, and the Jewish leadership of Kishwada, in effect, was transformed into the Jewish Council, and there was a Jewish so-called police established, and there was some allotment of food, very minimal, so that immediately we had to begin to organize some kind of an underground food supply. Of course, there was no medication, and immediately we had to begin to organize that. And then there was, of course, a skyrocketing death rate immediately, including a considerable number of suicides on the part of the more assimilated Jews, or even converted, the few converts that existed in that lived in Kishwada. Became a serious problem.
Okay, we're going to take a break at this moment. Thank you. Philip Katz. Philip, can you tell me a little bit about the relationship between the Jewish community and the non-Jewish community in Kishvarda prior to the war?
To define the relationship of the Jews and non-Jews in Hungary is not an easy task. You would have to have a complete sociological, political, and historical exposition. You have to understand that although in the eyes of the non-Jews, Jews were Jews, still there were very substantial differences in the relationship between Jews and non-Jews, dependent on the history of the area and the nature of the Jewish and non-Jewish communities in the given area and era. I come from Kishwada, which was in the very northeast of the country, virtually on what then was the Czech border and later on became the Russian border and the Polish border. The Jewish community of Kishwada was, by and large, I would say at least one-third, if not more, relatively new, recent immigrants from the East. They were, particularly the Hasidic element, who were stranger than the so to say, native Jews who were there and belonged to the Jewish community before the days of Franz Josef and what they called the dual monarchy. And so that is on the Jewish side, so to say. On the non-Jewish side, you have to realize that in the area where I had lived, I would say that the non-Jewish population was overwhelmingly what they called Roman Catholic. There were some Eastern Catholics too, but and there were some Reformed churches too, but the overwhelming majority of the population was non-Jewish population was Roman Catholic, very fundamentalist kind of Catholicism, in a very real sense, quite primitive too. Their clergy was almost primitive, and then at the time, even in my days, I would say that illiteracy was probably around 60%. It was an agrarian area. In fact, our city was, so to say, the marketplace as well as the commercial center and administrative center for a very large agrarian area. Children would be sent by their parents, other than the professional element or the gentry, military officers, etc., would go to the required four elementary grades or six elementary grades, and then they would, of course, become part of the real struggle to maintain their existence. And so the relationship of the Jews and the non-Jews was made up of this primitive, religious, and illiterate aura of the area. And so that although that you would find that there were Jews who had relationships with non-Jews, some even quite close, certainly at the level of the thin layer of very assimilated Jews and professionals and the bankers, there were pretty close relationships and maybe business partnerships. But there was a wall separating the two communities that could not be penetrated and could not be broken down. Even at the level of the of the assimilated Jews, the social life which, again, you know, Jews in a sense imitated the Hungarian gentry at that level. Nonetheless, they were separate, basically. A very interesting story of it's a kind of interesting historical vignette. In the area, there was a woman from one of the gentry families who married a Jew and who was invited to the annual New Year's ball but was told to leave her husband behind. That sort of, I would say, symbolizes that level of contact. As far as the average Hungarian and the average Jew, who usually was a bearded Jew or at least wore black clothes, and certainly the Hasidim who wore kaftans, and was, you know, their contact was limited to the bare essentials. And they really didn't know each other and, for that matter, looked down upon each other for their respective reasons. And by the time of 1944, the atmosphere was charged with animosity that you know, was the result of by then at least 20-25 years of virulent anti-Semitism practiced by the government, to the point where at times it was physically dangerous for the Jews, or the Jews were in physical danger on Christian holidays, particularly when they had parades, it became very touchy. But most of all, there was this this awareness that they were they and we were we, and that never the twain shall meet. So it's a very difficult proposition, and you know, the history of the Holocaust in Hungary, or the Hungarian aspect of the Holocaust, is marked by is something very interesting. You know, we in the Northeast were the dispensable Jews. Horthy, for instance, more or less considered the Jews of Budapest and the western part of the country, who were more assimilated, more Hungarianized, less strange in their physical appearance. He more or less considered those his Jews. And that was one of the reasons why he halted the deportation at a certain point. It was after that resumed, of course, when he fell in October 15th, I believe, of 1944. Even though that he was a dyed-in-the-wool anti-Semite, but he was a gentlemanly anti-Semite, and he would not have thought of burning Jews, or certainly had some concern for the image of Hungary in the world. And so he was ready to dispense with these Northeastern Jews who were really basically Galician Jews, and they were not really Hungarians. And of course, the population was aware of this attitude. And in some ways, it was a kind of a symbiotic relationship, because on the one hand, that was the demand of the population to which the authorities responded, and on the other hand, the authorities have encouraged that attitude. So there was, as I said, this wall that existed between the various elements of the non-Jewish community and the various elements of the Jewish community. It depended on its nature, or its character, depended on the nature of the elements of the community. If you were a Hasidic Jew, obviously you were a stranger, and if you were a plain peasant in Hungary, you may have even had warm feelings towards the Jews, but you wouldn't want to get involved with them. You wouldn't want to become, you know, not only not part of their family, but you wouldn't want to be involved in their existence and in their life. And vice versa, obviously. You know, to the Jews, in a way, the non-Jews were primitive, uncouth, and in the same fashion, you can just imagine yourself being a non-Jew and suddenly watch a Jew with his kaftan and talus around his neck and a shtrambel on a Saturday. What a strange apparition that was for him. So even where there was no animus, and there was plenty of that, certainly among the gentry, you know, the gentry felt itself, I would say, displaced by the Jews and demanded to take the place of the Jews.
Prior to 1939, did you ever personally feel that you were in physical danger at any time?
Actually, you know, I was in physical danger as a student in the elementary school. At times, our teacher would keep the few Jews that went to the government school, like myself, during the pauses that we used to have between every hour for about 10 minutes or so. He would consider it the better part of wisdom to keep us in the classroom, because if we went outside, we were bound to clash with the, you know, 99% of the non-Jewish students who, you know, needed really no cause to pick a fight and to bloody our noses.
And did that ever happen?
Yes, it did. Of course it did.
Philip, can you tell me something about your family, if we could start with your father?
I hope you have several years available. My father, whose name in Hungarian was Menyhert, M-E-N-Y-H-E-R-T, but whose Hebrew and Yiddish names were Menachem Mendel, was, I would say, a well-known personality in Hungary and beyond. He was one of those not rare but infrequent lay people who insisted on remaining a lay person, but was a renowned rabbinic scholar, descendant, as he used to say, son after one of the great rabbis whose books are today still currently studied in the yeshivot, certainly in the Orthodox yeshivot. He was a rather unusual man in many ways, quite handsome, dressed in a kind of a semi-Hasidic style, very natty, because he was traveling and his business was wine and liquor and beer, wholesaler and exporter above all. The business main portion was export. He used to have his clothes made in London. He was also a man of very big concepts. Not very practical, because his mind was always on his Talmudic studies. I think I could best indicate to you how he conceptualized all sorts of major business moves, that while the Congress of the United States debated whether or not to withdraw the prohibition, I don't remember what amendment to the Constitution it was, I think the 22nd Amendment, I really don't know the number. My father already had two boatloads of wine on it and liquor on its way to the United States. But, you know, he could conceptualize these major business moves, but for execution and for management, he had to rely entirely on my mother, who not only, of course, was more at home with Hungarian and understood administration and correspondence and cables and things of that kind, but was far more practical, right, in a certain sense than my father was. My father was a kind of a very bookish man in a way. He had a huge library of rabbinical books, and was what in the world knows from Chaim Nachman Bialik's famous poem. He was a matmid. He was he could be lost for days and nights in his books. He was much sought after, particularly as an expert in halakha. Very frequently called in by rabbinic courts to be an arbitrator or what, or a dayan, or what they call a borer, which really is a kind of a counsel come defense lawyer or something like that. Curiously enough, although he was a star student of a very famous rabbi, the Hasidic rabbi, the Munkacher Rebbe, who was quite an institution himself, he was not really a Hasid in what came to be known in the philosophical sense, and certainly what it came to be known in the literature of Hasidism, late Hasidism. He was not. He was too rational and too involved in the rationale or rational approach of the Talmud and rabbinic literature. So he was not given to this to the mysticism which Hasidism absorbed and propagated. Even his attire sort of separated him from Hasidism, although in his observance he was as strict as a Hasid. But in his ideas and in his, I would say, his interests, he was not really a Hasid. Of course, he was very strict and very stiff-necked, and above all, extremely principled. He could tolerate no compromise when it came to what he considered Judaism. There was either his way or no way at all. Anything that in the slightest way departed from his conception of Judaism was beyond the pale of Judaism and could not be tolerated, certainly in his own family. And he would make no compromises. He couldn't. To him, the slightest compromise would have been tantamount to hypocrisy. And he was very intolerant in that sense.
How did that affect your relationship with him?
My relationship with my father was, in retrospect, I guess I should call it very unfortunate, because I was no less devoted and dedicated to Judaism in my perception and my conception of Judaism, and certainly in the perpetuation of Jews and Judaism. And I was as determined and as stiff-necked in my way as he was in his way. The result was that since I was thoroughly Jewish, I was more than happy to attempt to study and meet him on the level of rabbinic studies. But beyond that point, when it came to observance or when it came to our relationship so to say, to the outside world, there was a complete disjuncture between my father and myself. There was absolutely no relationship. So my relationship with my father, I would say, could be summarized by an ongoing contest between myself and him. I wanted to demonstrate to him that I could be as knowledgeable in Judaism as he was, or as he wanted me to be, without being observant as he was.
Were there any activities that you participated in that he would not have sanctioned?
Well, to the extent that he was aware of it, and when he was aware of it, of course, it was a bitter struggle between, even from my earliest childhood on, between two stubborn, relentless wills, his and mine. I had ceased to be observant in a real sense at the age of 5. I had in part, and this is a completely other part of the story, in part because of my mother's influence, become aware of the world at a very early age, and not only wanted to be part of it, but burrowed into it, with the result that by the age of 5, I would say, or certainly very shortly after that, I had rejected Hungary. I had become, perhaps without the formal definition, a Zionist and nationalist and cultural nationalist Jew, and very involved with the world, became politically conscious, and so I literally had left the fold of my father at a very young age, and eventually, quite naturally, tended to more formalized Zionism to the extent that it existed in our town, and that's another separate story of how it existed and how it didn't exist, and became an adherent of Shamarat Tzair, certainly at that time, and for a long time to come, the most extreme left-wing socialist Zionism, and remained devoted to the essence of Shamarat Tzair's philosophy to this day, and probably to my dying day, and became very involved with it, and actively involved in participating in, to the extent and whenever it was possible for me. The conflict between my father and myself was ceaseless and in many ways brutal. Because, as I've said, we have had two really strong wills pitted against each other with uncompromisingly. I was no less uncompromising than my father. So that my relationship with my father, and I have a great conflict about this with my sisters, they had loved my father very deeply, and their relationship with him was close, even in a physical sense. Girls were given a much looser rein. They didn't have to they didn't have to shoulder all of the burdens of Jewish observance and Jewish ritual as strictly as a boy had to. And on top of everything else, I was the only boy. I was the Kaddishal, and I had to be, if not a clone of my father, but even more than my father, if that is possible. And so the demands on me were much stronger and stricter and broader.
In terms of your academic achievement then in Hungary prior to the war?
Well, it was nil. One of my sisters taught me how to read when I was about 4 years old. And I took an exam, such as it was,
in 1944,
and got into second grade, and then went to three grades, and that was the end of my formal education.
And in 1944, did you complete any religious education that your father may have expected of you?
Well, I had gone to a series of cheders and Talmud Torah and Yeshivot and Yeshiva Ketana, and eventually I was ordained as a rabbi. As I recently said to someone, the most disbelieving rabbi there ever was.
We're going to take a break now. Thank
sure.
you, Philip. Interviewing Philip Katz. Philip, we were just talking about your father. Can you tell me something about your mother?
Something is almost impossible because of the extraordinary personality of my mother. It would take a lifetime to describe her. But I will try to compress and still give some kind of a picture of her. My mother was the daughter of the chief rabbi of Hajdunanash. On her mother's side, she was a descendant of, at least we know from the early 16th century, of the first chief rabbi of Buda. She was one of, 1, 2, 3, 4 girls and 2 boys. My grandfather was a very young man when he passed away. He was very ill, I'm assuming, because of the descriptions, that he must have had cancer. And my mother, as a very young woman, was traveling with him from Budapest to Prague to Vienna to various experts and institutions that hopefully were going to cure him, which they didn't succeed, of course. My mother's personal ambition all her life was to have become a doctor, and was considered by the doctors who have met her because of her being the companion and nurse of my grandfather, apparently had unusual talents and capabilities in that direction, but of course she was not permitted to go to school. And in fact was married off early, as were the other girls, so that my grandfather would be alive or live to see the marriages of his children. Her two brothers were both rabbis. In fact, the older brother has, I think he was the older brother, has inherited his father's rabbinic seat. My mother, perhaps in a completely autodidact way, because she, as I said, she had no opportunity for schooling, became a highly intelligent, extremely knowledgeable, and very literate intellectual, to the point where she literally maintained what perhaps in different circumstances and in a different age would have been called a salon. Our house became a kind of almost a debating society where all the town's intellectuals congregated, literally sitting at her feet, and where intellectual firsts have been flying day and night, virtually, which in and of itself had a tremendous impact on me and on my sisters, because obviously we couldn't be kept out of it. We wouldn't go to bed, and we wouldn't leave the room where this fiery debate and discussion of the world and all its ills were being discussed, analyzed, taken apart, and put back together. My mother, who was obviously a completely observant Jew and wore a shetel, was nonetheless really the most sophisticated and, as far as we the children are concerned, certainly the most complete and the most completely human being that we have ever known, the most civilized and wisest of all people, as far as we are concerned, and this holds true for my sisters too. She never died. We sort of spend our life trying to measure up to what may be our idealized ideal of her, and measure our lives and our actions to her standards to this day.
What was her name at birth?
Her name was Teresa Halpert, T-R-E-Z-A-H-A-L-P-E-R-T. She had a tremendous impact, not only on us, but on the wider surroundings, much sought for her wise counsel, and looked up to by everyone who certainly who met her, and by many who have only known of her by reputation. She also, I think, bequeathed to me, who at a certain point in her life was probably the closest to her, because my father had been out of the house since 1939, having gone to America. And during those days, I had to assume the role of the man of the house. So I became, I'm sure that my sisters feel that way about their respective relationships, but I think I became the closest collaborator of hers and closest friend of hers, because there were areas of life that she didn't have to share with my sisters but had to share with me. I became something of a helper in and breadwinner in the last 3-4 years before the Holocaust.
How did your father get to the United States in 1939?
Well, my father finally, because it became physically dangerous for him to attempt to continue in the United States, I mean in Hungary, finally permitted himself to be persuaded by my mother to go to the United States. Ostensibly, he came to represent Hungarian wine and liquor export to the World's Fair in 1939 at New York. But with the intention of what he considered to weather the storm, maybe it'll take 6 months or so. He had been to the United States before, and my mother, who sensed way, way back the inevitability of the tragedy that was lurking at us and at the Jewish community of Hungary, was begging him for years to go to the United States, but of course he wouldn't go because, as the saying went in Yiddish, in America you can't be a Jew. So he refused, but when it became physically impossible for him, as I say, he came under this subterfuge, and then eventually he realized that he had to stay, and eventually got stuck because the great power Hungary declared war on the United States. And in fact, he finally managed to get immigration papers for us, and we were invited to come to the consulate in Budapest or the embassy, but it was already too late. However, what I started to say is that my mother also imparted to me and endowed me with one of the most important, I would say, facts of my life. She herself managed to construct for herself very unique kind of synthesis between her Judaism and her humanitarianism, and she managed to live in these two worlds, as I have, thanks to her, been able to live in this perhaps bipolar world without feeling any dichotomy. I feel myself perfectly integrated as a Jew and a human being without any either emotional or intellectual problems resulting from being, so to say, one foot in the Jewish world and one foot in the world at large.
What became of your mother?
Unfortunately, she, like so many of Hungarian Jews, was murdered the day we arrived in Auschwitz.
You have siblings. Can you tell me something about them?
I've had five sisters who were alive in 1944. Actually, the family, my mother had two twin boys who died at the age of 3 to 6 months. But there were six of us. I was the only boy. My sister, Yolande, Bertha, Isabella, and Regina, and Helen were all living at home in the time of the Holocaust, and or when the Holocaust set in. They were all very like each other, all, but at the same time, of course, all different personalities. And all of them striving to make themselves into the image of my mother, just like I did.
Who was the eldest?
My sister Yolande was the eldest.
Yolande Katz?
Yes.
Was she known by any other names?
Yes, we called her in the family Tippi. My sisters were kind of elegant young women in town. They were kind of fashionable, and they were. The whole family was rather well-respected and well-known family, and so you know, they too were looked up to by their peers, and in their case too, as has been the case in my particular case, we had certain following. We were almost all pipers in that sense. We all had a coterie of friends who sort of looked upon us as the trendsetters and the pace setters. It wasn't only that we were friends, but we somehow we were, as I say, the trendsetters for them.
Just for the record, Philip, if you could list clearly the names of each sister, mm-hmm. and spell them.
Well, Yolande, as I have told you, is J-A-L-O-N. She was the oldest. Or is it the eldest? And then came Bertha, B-R-T-A, whose nickname was Chicha. In Hungarian, that is spelled C-S-I-C-S-A, and means big mouth. She was and is a big mouth. And then came Isabella, who was known as Baby, and in the family was called Madame Drama because she had this dramatic flair which she has retained for all her life. She's indeed a very dramatic personality, and incidentally was not only dramatic in the sense of being very attractive. She's extremely beautiful, and impressive. But she always wanted to be an actress, and was fairly well known in town for her impersonation of all sorts of actresses, particularly Joan Crawford. And she has retained that that dramatic flair in everything, in her appearance. She can write a postcard, and it's a big drama on a small postcard. Then came my sister Regina, who is R-E-G-I-N-A, and who was generally known by her Hebrew name with a diminutive. We either called her Rivka or Rivkele, usually. She was the only one who managed to go to junior high, and but could never finish because she was thrown out as a Jew in 1944 or 43. I don't really remember. She too was interested in being a an actress, and I think I've shown you a picture of one of the plays that she has participated in. And incidentally, I should tell you that my sister Berta was at one time considered one of the potentially great poetesses of Hungary. And interestingly enough, she ceased to write when she came to the United States. The change of language and culture apparently, apparently, you know, robbed her of the vehicle to express herself on the one hand, and on the other hand, she got married virtually 10 days after she arrived from the United States, and she became a housewife and a mother. And peculiarly enough, my sister Isabella, who was the performer, so to say, eventually became the writer and has published several books on the Holocaust, including a children's book for ages 8 and 9, which is supposed to be the only one directed at so far at that age level. And it's been a tremendous success. Her other two books have been translated into a half a dozen languages, and certainly part of every Holocaust course and library. My sister Regina was always sought out for her recitation of poetry, even to the point where in the fairly dark days already at Hungarian National Independence Day, I suppose you would call it, despite the fact that she was a Jew, she was invited to recite the great national hymn or anthem at the public observance. Reciting poetry was, in those days in Hungary, as in other parts of Europe, was considered a great art.
Can you tell me about your youngest sibling?
That is probably the most difficult for myself and for my sisters. My younger sister was about 13 or going on 13 when we arrived in Auschwitz and was sent to her death with my mother. It has been probably the most difficult thing for us to endure, because having been the youngest, we all doted on her. We all, each and every one of us, we always catch ourselves talking and thinking and feeling about her as though she was our child. Every one of us, we each claim, so to say, to be the parent. She was an extraordinarily beautiful and sensitive girl, and we all poured our whole existence into her. we all saw in her the incarnation of the best that we had. And all our hopes and aspirations were concentrated and distilled in her. We perhaps unconsciously hoped that whatever fate befell us, she will see a better day and she will live in a more human world, in a more humane world. That she was lost is somehow the greatest loss to us, because she was the quintessential impersonation and incarnation of all that we were and all that we wanted to be and all that we hoped to be and all that we hoped for the Jews, for humanity, and for the world. It's extremely difficult for us to this day to, in the first place, see her as, by now she would be a woman of in her late 50s or something like that, or 60s. We, of course, always see her as we saw her then. And we can't make our peace with her not being. Perhaps it's the same with other families too. She was all. And in a very real sense, she really still is. We don't exist without her, because she exists for us always in a very real way. It's the same as my mother.
Philip, can you take me to the days before the ghetto was established in Kishvarda? What was happening? What did you see? What were people talking about?
Well, obviously everybody was, the town was in an uproar, the people were wrought up, completely bewildered, without counsel. The leadership of the community, in a very broad sense, and certainly in a historic sense, has failed as the Hungarian Jewish leadership has failed, perhaps in large measure as a result of circumstances and not because of their own fault. They were paralyzed. And they, by and large, insisted on hanging on to this most unrealistic and impractical notion that the community in the city was going to be unharmed. And one of the sinful result of it was that that it was difficult to get help for those who were already in effect in the ghetto, although they were then moved into another location in what became the ghetto, until virtually the last day. I have to this day, I have all sorts of difficulties with this. I remember a former president of the community that I went to and asked him to give me money so I could buy food and clothing or whatever for the people who had been brought in before we were put into the ghetto. and he virtually threw me out. In a way, it's quite understandable. You know, they, aside from the fact that they could not cope with, they couldn't expect it to be to cope with the events. It was not conceivable for them, and so you certainly couldn't be prepared for it. And aside from the fact that they were, there was a total dislocation, and disorientation. But aside from all of that, there was this idea of fix that they could somehow save themselves. And the day that was set for us to be, or the next morning for us to be put into the ghetto, that poor man ran after me with literally a basket full of cash. It finally sank in. And it's a very painful thing, though, you know, no one should blame anyone. The events and the circumstances were so completely beyond the human ken that even in hindsight, it would be difficult to prescribe what would be the right behavior, what would be the right action to take, or the right advice to give.
Philip, we're going to take a break now.
Sure.
Philip, you were just describing the days before the Jewish community in Kishvarta moved into the ghetto.
It is terribly important for people to realize that the Jews were penned in and pitted against such immense powers that there was no possibility to know what to do, and certainly there was no possibility for any really meaningful defense or resistance. This is by and large true of all of Central and Eastern European Jewry. But it is, I would say, with much greater force, true of Hungary.
Although it's 1944.
It is 1944, and the collapse of Germany was reasonably certain by that time, and certainly could be expected. I certainly was convinced that the war couldn't go on for much longer, and I, you know, we know from history that most of the Allies also saw, so to say, the end of the war, foresaw the victory. But Hungary was locked in. There was, for years, no border of Hungary that was not occupied by Germany, or that was free of German-supported and German-guided domestic Nazis. And there was no way in which you could organize, obtain the means of defense or armament. There was no escape route, really. At one time, the Romanian Jews came to Hungary because it seemed to have been a little better there. And then after the Romanians opted out of war, some of Hungarian Jews ran to Romania. There was no outlet. There was no border. There were no means of communication.
Did you have any knowledge of what was happening to the Jewish community in Eastern Europe at that time?
I had what probably was as good knowledge as could be had before the before Vrba and the Slovakian Jews became aware of the actual details of the Auschwitz annihilation process, which was somewhat later than we were deported already. But I had a pretty good general knowledge of the tragedy that was that had befallen by that time most of Central and Eastern European Jewry, and that was awaiting us. In part, that came from a simple political consciousness and from following events, and from being aware of the world that we lived in. But it was also buttressed by several bits of reliable information, as reliable as you could get and as much as you could get. First of all, after the Polish debacle, at one point, Hungary opened its borders for the Polish army to traverse Hungary after they surrendered their weapons. And we had managed, when they were coming across, to contact and spirit away some of the Jewish, Polish Jewish soldiers who had pretty good information on the atrocities that have already taken place. This was in the very early days, but it was. And then bits of information obviously filtered through, even through that thick curtain that was drawn around each of the occupied countries, and or for that matter, each of the Axis countries, and certainly around the Holocaust. But you know, the Holocaust was no secret, in essence,
in those days,
either to the Jews or to the world at large. And perhaps therein lies one of the more serious elements of the tragedy, that despite the awareness, even if it wasn't quite accurate or the information wasn't complete, nobody did what should have been done. How much could have been done remains an open question, and certainly is questionable enough not to be very firm about condemning anyone and anybody, at least till late 43 or middle of 43 and 44, when perhaps the Allies could have done a lot more could have done something, because essentially nothing was done.
Philip, can you take me to the day that you and your family moved into the ghetto?
Well, we were all told in our city through placards and through announcements in the Hungarian small towns, there used to be what public proclamations. There was a uniformed man who would go around and bang on a drum, and people would collect, and he would read out the latest regulations or rules issued by whatever authorities. And we were told that one fine morning at 4 o'clock we all have to be ready and packed, and we could take I don't remember, about 50 kilos of belongings and food to with us, and to be ready to be moved into the ghetto, which was a pretty makeshift affair in our town, in part because it was relatively God-forsaken primitive area on the one hand, and on the other hand because they knew that it was going to be for a very brief period. So essentially all that was done is that one area of this, on either side of this Star Street, was designated as the ghetto. And families were, when we were driven out of our homes, we went in there, and families settled in with whomever they could. It was kind of rough and tumble. Again, unfortunately, human nature doesn't really provide for extraordinary circumstances on the whole. It was difficult for the people who were moving in with other people, and it was difficult for the people who were to take in other people. You know, who is going to sleep in what corner? How are you going to manage to divide this space in which maybe five people lived before, and now they're going to have to house 50? And how are you going to manage to acquire and prepare food, and how are you going to manage to keep yourself clean and wash? And the myriad little details of daily existence, which have become so terribly problematic within a matter of hours, and for which no one had a ready solution, because no one could prepare themselves for it. And it was very difficult on everybody. And I do not have to tell you what happens to tempers and nerves under that kind of stress, which, while everybody tried heroically to be as cooperative as they possibly could, but it really was stretching every nerve, and the stress was just overwhelming for everyone.
Can you describe the place where you and your mother and sisters lived, and how many people were with you?
As I recall, there was some 30-some-odd people in this apartment, which was basically a one-floor small house, and there was an attic, I remember I sort of got myself organized on the attic and brought some other young people there. And there really wasn't any time even to organize yourselves to the point where it that was possible, because I think it was less than 3 weeks maybe that we were all in the ghetto, and then we were deported. So before, you know, you could kind of organize yourself and establish some kind of a routine and rules of behavior and order, we were gone.
You arrived in the ghetto approximately...
I think it was Shavuot, but I'm not certain. I really have no recollection of dates and exact timing, although it's recorded and I've seen it, but I simply don't remember it myself now. The year was 1944 in May. It must have been, you know, we must have been put into the ghetto in the last days of April or the first days of May. And by May 29th, we were deported.
How old were you then?
I was 19. I was 19 the preceding March.
What were you and your friends talking about during those days?
Well, we talked very little, to tell you the truth, because we were so damn busy. What little organization, what little provision, what little, burying of people, what little attempt to... bring medication and some whatever kind of surcease to the afflicted was us, a few young people.
You had the freedom to come and go out of the ghetto?
We were supposed to be, I too was in what they call the ghetto police, which was headed by one of the prominent assimilated Jews. And it shouldn't be, I shouldn't even call it that, because it had no relationship to what we know about the ghettos of Poland, or the police, the Jewish police of the ghettos of Poland, and no relationship whatsoever. But we were sort of trying to not so much maintain order as carrying out the orders that were given to the Jews via the council. And so, for instance, they would permit us to take the dead out and bury them in the cemetery. And that enabled us to do certain things by being outside of the ghetto. Bringing in some food or some medication or through bribery and through chicanery and through whatever we could. And so there was very little time and opportunity for communication, though in our house again it was, you know, a little more so than in the average homes. I remember in that attic, you know, where we used to congregate as much as we could. And we talked obviously of the immediate problems, and we were in quest of immediate solutions to very real practical problems on the one hand. The other hand, obviously, we talked about the hopes for an early end to the war before we all die right then and there, so to say. And we talked of resistance. What could resistance be? We collected and piled up stones in various areas throughout the ghetto, in the naive belief that if and when either the opportunity arose or the need arose, we would try to defend ourselves with stones. We got ourselves somehow the so-called police, and not even really, I shouldn't even call it that. We all got ourselves a big stick. That sort of was our uniform. And we were hoping that those sticks are going to come in handy. Some of us hid a few axes that weren't surrendered or weren't discovered. There was a punishment auxiliary, labor auxiliary, in what used to be the hotel, the backyard of which abutted the ghetto, and we were supposed to, there was a little kind of walkway created by two sets of planks or wood, which we were supposed to, within which we were supposed to patrol, and one side was opened into that the backyard of this former hotel. And so we somehow managed to communicate with these more mature people who were in the camp, and again attempting to try to devise some fashion or some way of escape and of organizing or of resisting. It was all a very macabre kind of thing, because there really was not much reality to it. There couldn't have been. We did also prepare a couple of hiding places for people who were willing to hide without when we sort of realized and knew that we were going to be deported. And in fact, just in preparation for this recording, I, at your request, I was looking at some pictures. I bumped up against one of the pictures of the person who was the Rosh Ken of Hashem Retzair in Kishwada, who hid out in one of the places that we prepared and survived and came to Palestine in I think already in 45. I really think that the best way for me to describe this nightmare is that it was all one big macabre dance of death that we were all dancing, some unconsciously and some consciously, or more consciously than others. But it was really just a dance of death.
Did the average resident in the ghetto have access to outside of the ghetto?
No.
No. Who at that time was patrolling externally?
It was all the Hungarian gendarme. As a matter of fact, to the best of my recollection, and although I have learned since then that Eichmann apparently had visited Kishwada once, there was one young SS man who was guiding, directing, and maybe even commanding the local gendarme. But they really needed very little guidance or very little help. The Hungarian gendarmerie was a particularly brutal and aggressive and wild institution from its very inception, and they were in charge, for all intents and purposes, To what extent they were guided by the Germans is something that I don't know, but as I say, they needed very little guidance. Interestingly enough, one of the plans we hatched, the other side of the ghetto or of Star Street, the end of where the Jewish school was, just behind where the Jewish school was, and that was all part of the ghetto. There were about 12,000 people in the ghetto in Kishwada, so you can imagine they were all squeezed into, I would say, within the equivalent of in built-up area of about two blocks, maybe three, I don't know. But you know, school and the synagogues and even the slaughterhouse, everything was filled with people. But it backed into the offices and the guard room of the gendarmerie. And one of the plans that we were hatching and trying to figure out how we could do it was to break into that guardhouse and do away with whatever gendarmes we could and get their weapons. Of course, it never came to it. And this is another element and aspect of it. It holds true in many ways for other areas, of course, and for the whole question of resistance, the whole question of time, you know. Before you could, and perhaps there was something conscious about this, that and planful on the part of the Germans, there was really never any time to organize or to plan or to carry out any kind of plan. Before you knew it, the circumstances changed so drastically that no matter what your plans were, you couldn't carry them out. You were already taken away or killed. This is, by the way, one of the very important philosophical, practical questions. The whole concept of time in the Holocaust was something that was beyond the normal human circumstances. No one really can, who has not been there, can appreciate. But this is just one really relatively smaller element of it. But the circumstances were so unpredictable, so unreliable, so swiftly changing, that certainly in our ghetto, but every place else in the camps and in the other ghettos, that you could not plan and you could not pursue a plan.
What were you and your mother and sisters discussing in those days prior to deportation at home?
Dreamed and attempted somehow to make contact with my father and thought maybe he can save us in the last moment. Of course, we couldn't. We had for several years maintained contact with my father through Switzerland, but you couldn't even post a letter. And again, if we had posted a letter, by the time it arrived in Switzerland, we were burnt. So, you know, we were discussing, is there a way in which we can notify our father and maybe he can do something, invoke some kind of a deus ex machina and save us. We were, of course, all trying to somehow fortify and save each other in all sorts of ways that we could. I had actually left the ghetto once, having been firmly convinced that it was a hopeless situation, and believing that you know, whoever can should save himself, so there will be a Sheherit Israel, a remnant. But as so many others, I couldn't countenance leaving my family, so I came back. I came back voluntarily and have been in, it's a peculiar word to use in for something like that, but have been happy ever since that I have done it, that I have been able to provide some comfort, some easement, some encouragement, some strength for the rest of my family, and the same goes for them. They, I'm sure, felt the same way.
You had mentioned earlier that on occasion you were able to leave the ghetto to bury the dead, and you brought back in food and medicine. Was that openly bringing that food and medicine in, or?
Sorry?
Did you openly, for the guards, bring in the food and medicine?
No, at one time, you know, we bought off the gendarme who was our guard. At another time, we snuck one of the boys away, and one time I sneaked away and went into the back door of an apothecary and just broke it open and slept out whatever I could. It was all very makeshift and very much dependent on the opportunity of the moment. Everything was like that, and again, I don't know how I can sufficiently impress you with this problem of time, which was a completely different dimension and category than what is normal to people. Into human existence, we were in the jaws of death every moment.
Philip, we're going to take a break now.
Sure.
Continue. Philip, you were just talking about the very last days of the ghetto.
I should have described to you when I mentioned that we managed to somehow smuggle in some food and some medication. Mostly we did it in the casket that we took the dead out. As you know, in Orthodox cemeteries particularly, people are buried in their shrouds without actual caskets. And we smuggled the food and medication in the ostensibly empty basket on the way back from the burials. That really was one of the main sources. There were a few other ways in which we could manage to obtain one thing or another, but very little. And again, it in one respect, it was time that was against us. He never had the time to organize or to plan.
When did you become aware of deportation?
Well, we were actually told that we were going to be deported. At least the Jewish Council was told, and of course, everybody got to know it. And then at one point, we were again told that we have to prepare for, they didn't call it deportation, of course, evacuation, or some other Ethiopian language, on a certain date, which I gathered that in our case, and I don't know whether I was in the first or the second transport from Kishwarda, was in on May 29, 1944. It was a pretty messy affair. We all supposedly had to present ourselves just at the front of the ghetto. People were slowly coming early in the morning with whatever the weight allowance, I don't know what it was, because for days before that people were sewing all sorts of rucksack type things that they could, and suitcases and bags and sacks to squeeze in whatever they thought would help them save themselves, whatever they thought they would need or could use. Not, of course, realizing that that was really part of the of the German way of lulling people into believing that and there was something beyond what was, and maybe even better. It was a really elementary kind of psychology that they practiced, which was so useful to them in cowing the population that was to become the subject of their murder. The human psychology is such that you will not only cling to any kind of hope, but create elaborate scenarios for how it is going to be better even than it is, let alone not worse. And the notion when they tell you that you have to pack, I don't know, 50 kilograms of and a week long of food for the trip, it makes you think that there is a trip, that you'll be traveling, that you will be eating, that you will change your clothes, and that there will be a toilet, or it makes you think that there will be perhaps an inconvenience, but not utter and complete devastation.
Where were you told that you were being taken to?
East. The word was always east. Evacuation to the east, where all the Jews may have been brought together, where the enemy isn't going to reach us. After all, we were in real danger, you know. The Russians may come any minute, and what could be worse than that?
And who was telling you these things?
Well, the Germans would, that sole German officer and the gendarmerie would present themselves to the council, and they would tell the council that on such and such date there will be evacuation, and you have to tell the population that they should prepare themselves for in such and such a way, and they would put out placards in key spots in the ghetto. And the fact that they told you that you can take food and clothing along, or that you should, was sufficient to calm your worst fears. And this is the kind of simple, elementary psychology that the Germans practiced all over, in the concentration camps, every place. It isn't the gullibility of human beings, it's rather the desperate need of human beings to cling to life and to cling to the positive, the hopeful, which was exploited. So I'm sure that at certain levels it was very conscious and very planful on the part of the Germans. But you really didn't have to be conscious and planful about it. If you were a German SS man and you were told from higher-ups that you announced that there was going to be a deep evacuation and the evacuees will be allowed to take 50 kilograms each
Do you remember clothing. What you took? Do you
what?
Remember, do you remember personally what you took with you?
Well, I know a few things that I was very particular about. One was I had a pair of boots, very heavy mountain climbing boots from my days in Switzerland, and I was very sure to take that. And, you know, we all tried to get, mind you, this was going into the summer, but everybody tried to take some winter clothing along because, after all, we're going to be evacuated east. East is cold, you know. and, of course, people tried to stuff in as much food as they could lay their hands on. Everybody had different ideas of what was advisable.
Can you take me back to the day of deportation?
So, you know, people began to pour out of these the homes in the ghetto where they were onto this Star Street. And by that time, since we were more directly under the control of the gendarme, because they never came inside the ghetto, they, so to say, ruled through the Jewish council, and by guarding the perimeter. But here they began to drive us with considerable brutality. There is my sister's, and my sister Isabel has actually described it in her book. We were being squeezed into a line. This is, I never in my life want to hear the word five in a row, because that seemed to have been fixed in the minds of the German. We have to line up five to a row. And they were shoving and pushing and shouting and total disarray, of course, and chaos, because, you know, the lame and the halt and the dumb and the blind, and they couldn't be told to keep order and to stay in line, and they would lash out at them. And apparently this young SS man had a whip, and he lashed out with a whip at my mother, and
he whipped your mother?
Was what?
He whipped your mother?
Yeah, he lashed out at my mother, and I apparently I was just about to jump him. And the girls, Isabel and Chicha, with all the force that they could manage, they held me back. because they, I in my blind rage, didn't, but they realized that we would all be dead, and oh, my mother would be killed in front of our eyes. So they held me back, and it became, for some moments, a very angry encounter between myself and my sisters.
Do you recall the name of this SS man?
No. I never met him before and never saw him after. Anyway, we somehow, they managed to drive us and to whip us till what was called in Kishwada, we had two railroad stations. One was called the big one and the other one was called the small one, the small station. And the small station had a spur going into a lumber yard of another Jew, not the one that I had mentioned before, where there was a huge, vast area, you know, of the yard. And there were the cattle cars, and we were being shoved into it and beaten into it and forced into it. There were a couple of people who managed to escape from there. You know, again, from our vantage point, this was total chaos. Clearly, we were not an organized group. And but the Germans and the gendarmes, they knew exactly what they were doing. They were whipping us into the.
Can you recall your thoughts as you were entering this car?
Can I recall my? Yes, sure. How do I make my mother and my sisters as comfortable as is humanly possible? How do I get everything that we thought we may need, all the bags, many of them, you know, were just strewn about, either almost voluntarily or because they were being driven and beaten into the cars, and they just lost it. People would run back to try to catch it. And personally, my whole preoccupation was with how do I make my family how do I make it as bearable as possible?
Approximately how many people were in this cattle car with you?
80. We propped up our mother against in one corner with my little sister in front of her, and all of us all my sisters sort of surrounding them, barely enough room to stand. And people would fall down, and, you know, people died in the car. We were on our way for, I think, 3 nights when we crossed what used to be the old Czech border or a little past it. There was a town called Košice, K-O-S-I-C-I-E, in Slovakian, but in Hungarian it was known as Kosa, K-A-S-S-A. And there the Hungarian police formally handed us over to the SS. The trip was probably the most inhuman aspect of the Holocaust. It was impossible. I don't know how any of us survived it. I remember in Poland, and I'm trying to remember now what the name of the town was where we stood, where the train was halted for whatever the reason. And I had spoken to one of the guards. There was a guard to every train, to every cattle car. He was standing below, and we had just enough of a slit in the one window that you usually have on these cattle carts, which, by the way, was boarded up, and I had broken it out so we could get a little bit of air. Other than that, there was no air at all. And I spoke to this SS man and handed him some rings and some money. And we got the car opened. And I went down to get some water. And then it seems to me that it must have been that he had either decided on his own, or they were going to do it anyway. Some of the other cars were also opened. And like myself, some of the younger people jumped out, and there was water for the train. And we collected some water in whatever dishes and pails people had, and emptied out some of the pails that we used for in the car for voiding, which was also, I presume, happened in every car, but it was a spontaneous idea of one of us, because there were no facilities. And so we got a little water. I remember that I had already taken off my shirt, and I let the water run all over me. And so we had a little water for each of the cars, probably lasted 10 minutes. And then we arrived in morning in Auschwitz. This is very interesting, you know. To us, it all seemed total chaos and disarray. I mean, we were pouring out of the railroad cars by the thousands. And there were, maybe half a dozen SS men with dogs hanging around, but there were, and there were these peculiar people with the striped suits rushing around and shouting, "Get out!" and "out!" and the dogs were barking, and it all seemed like total chaos. And yet, the Germans had very good order, without even knowing they were separating men and women. We didn't even realize it. We didn't have a chance to realize it. It all went like a well-oiled machine, even though that to us it looked chaotic. And these funny-looking striped people would drop a word here and a word there, or motion you're going up into smoke. And when you tried to hang on to something that you had brought, because they would tear it out of your hand and take it away. And they would tell you, "You're as good as dead," and all sorts of hints, drops, outright statements. And it all had to be done in seconds, because before you knew it, you were already 10 paces away. You were being shoved and pushed, all towards one goal. Towards Dr. Mengele. And you didn't know. You were just being literally pushed without your awareness of where you were going or why you were going, the sheer force of being driven and being shoved brought you dead.
Did you actually see Dr. Mingler?
Certainly. I have a feeling that the fact that I had, I think it was Sosnowitz, but I'm not sure where the train had stopped, and I had torn off my shirt. It was not only foul in those cars, but there was no air, and it was hot, even hotter than under this lamp. And I guess a strong young body, pretty muscly, is what Mengele saw, so he sent me to the life side.
Philip, how did you know this man you saw was Dr. Mengele?
I didn't know. I knew after I got in to the camp where everybody knew. I didn't know.
Did you ever see him again?
I don't even think that we realized really that this was what later we knew was selection. I mean, this man stood there with white gloves, and he just went like this. And you didn't even have a chance to look at him because you were being shoved and pushed. And the din and the noise and the barking of the dogs and the thing being hauled away and the train was being shoved back and forth and was screeching. It, you know, you had no awareness of your surroundings. You had no cognition. You knew that you were moving, but you didn't know where or how or who pushed you or who shoved you. There was no, and again, it's this factor of time, you know. It all happened in seconds, in minutes.
What is your last image of your mother in Helen?
I saw her being driven with other women. And, you know, that too, it like automatically they formed into a line of five in a row. And then subsequently I passed by and I saw her pajamas. And you know, you lost awareness of yourself or anyone else or anything because you were on a conveyor belt. You were constantly, your circumstances were constantly changing violently. I mean, here you were, you just passed Dr. Mengele and you were already marching forward and incidentally, I don't exactly now know at what hour we arrived, but by the time I got to where we were eventually put into the showers, after the fashion, it was a dead night. Believe me, I didn't notice that time has gone by and it went from day to night. Time has all flowed together and became one unrecognizable and undistinguishable and inseparable process. Kind of a flow without knowing certainly any difference between 1 hour and 1 day or 1 month or 1 year. It was an incredibly well-organized and efficient procedure that was elementary, and perhaps because of that, so effective. And everything about it was elementary.
Who were you with at that point, Philip?
I passed through Dr. Mangala. In front of me was the youngest brother of a lifelong friend of mine who lives in the United States. And I do not know to this day, and this is, again, part of the same problem in a way of the time. You know, Mangala was going like this. I don't know whether or not he didn't point him to go to the life side and me to the wrong side, and because the thing was moving so fast, by the time his finger moved to this side, I had gone past the other side. I don't know. I always have a question in my mind, whether or not. And most people have problems like that. I shouldn't say most people, but a lot of people have problems like that. Whether they did not go to the so-called life side in place of somebody else. Who knows? It was all one miasmic mess. It was, you know, the real truth, or one of the real truths about the Holocaust is that it is like God's name. It's ineffable. It can't be expressed. It can't be described, and it can't be communicated. I know it. You can never know it. It is beyond the ken of human beings who have lived maybe a not very good life, but have lived in on the planet Earth. We come from another planet.
Philip, we're going to take a break.
Sure.
Tape number 7, I'm interviewing Philip Katz. Philip, you were just describing your arrival in Auschwitz.
Somewhere in the dark, we were driven to the side of a huge building where we stood in line in the dark, and the line was moving forward towards one of these men in these striped suits who was sitting there, and pretty soon when I realized what he was doing, I saw that he was shaving the underarm and the pubic hairs of the people who by then were told to drop all their clothes in place, so to say, where they were. And it was really a fortuitous or was a serendipitous circumstance. I looked at this young man, and he looked at me, and we recognized each other. We had studied together in Switzerland, and he then told me to stay in place and let everybody come ahead of me, and as he was performing his duties, he talked to me. By the time it became finally my turn, there was nothing that could be known about Auschwitz that I didn't know. He had already been for 4 years in concentration camps.
And do you recall this person's name?
No. One of the things that he had told me was that the important thing was to get out of Auschwitz. And the only way to get out was to be needed, and the best way to be needed was to be useful to what was considered the war industry. And you're going to have to stop this.
Let's try to ignore it, please.
Okay. And so in turn, I had converted everybody into a mechanic, telling them that when and if the time came where they would ask what their trade or profession was, they should be mechanics. And eventually all 1,200 of us who finally were mustered out and brought into the barrack, we all knew that we had to be mechanics. And finally, one day, there was an officer of the Organisation Tot, which was the heavy construction organization of the Germans, state corporation, came in, and we were taken out one by one from the barrack. And he stood there with a proportional caliper in his hand, and I was asked to translate. And as each man approached, he would ask me to ask him what his profession was, and I would tell him, this man wants to know whether you're a mechanic, and I would turn back to him and say, he says he's a mechanic. And for the sake of variety, I would say, you know, he's a bicycle mechanic, a motorcycle mechanic, or a locksmith, or a this or a that. And so all 1,200 of us became mechanics. This is another aspect of this simplicity and almost primitivity of the whole procedure. That I could convert 1,200 people into mechanics, and you would have thought that the Germans in Hungary selected 1,200 mechanics from the whole country and brought them together and brought them to Auschwitz. Anyway, because we were mechanics, we were apparently, as it turned out to be later, hired out to the Air Force, and we left Auschwitz. There's a debate between myself and my sister where it was 2 weeks after we arrived or 3 weeks after we arrived. And I was taken to France, to a place which I later discovered was Longwy, and the camp was outside this town called Tilusigny, which was a mining area, and we were to have brought airplane fuselage factory into the mines and then build airplane fuselages. And this was the model, so to say, for the three other work camps that I was at, except for Dachau. It really was four camps, and except for Allach, It was all underground in mines originally. In France, it was in ore mines, and in Heilbronn and Neckar, it was in salt mines. I was, as the Allies moved westward or eastward for them, we were kept being evacuated, and I went from Tielusingi to either Heilbronn or Kochendorf or vice versa. I don't know exactly the which came first. And then from there I went to Dachau, and from Dachau I went to Allach, and in Allach we were working at the BMW factories, still supposedly building airplane fuselages. I think I can confidently say that we, in the 1 year that I was shuttled from one camp to another, I don't think that one fully completed piece of airplane fuselage ever left our factory. They have been half fabricated, but in most cases, obviously, we didn't know what the heck we were doing, and a lot of time was spent with sabotage, either on our part or on the part of other forced laborers who were in the area and who were involved in the same enterprise. And then from Allach, we were put in, actually, at times I had worked in other places, like the airport at Munich and railroads at Munich that were bombed out by the Allies. And in most of the times, I was called on to be a translator. When we were sent out from Allach, we were shuttled, I would say, not more than about 30 kilometers. It took about a week because the rails were bombed out, and probably there was no coal for the railroad, and maybe there wasn't even an engineer to drive the railroad. We just kept moving literally a kilometer or two, and then we would halt. And so this 30 kilometers to Tutzing, T-U-N-I-Z, or Z, I-N-G, we were on Lake Starnberg, rather famous resort area. And we finally halted at this railroad station, and we must have been there for 2 days or so. The highway apparently was running parallel to the railroad, maybe a few hundred yards away from the rails. And one fine day we saw, after we heard for the whole day the bombardment and the cannons, we saw on the one hand the Germans rushing helter-skelter away from there, and these beige tanks with a 4 or 5 pointed star, white star, coming towards us on the road. And then one of these tanks sort of peeled off, drove through the grass to the railroad, and some soldiers jumped out. We didn't know what kind of soldiers they were until sort of it became clear that they were Americans, and we were told we were liberated. And prior to that, I had made one of my many attempts to escape and was shot in the heel. And I was kind of bloodied. And some friends of mine or some fellow prisoners picked me up and they took me to a villa that was right next to the railroad station and deposited me there with two German women, obviously a mother and a daughter, who of course made their usual disclaimer that they didn't know anything about it and were very offended that they were being saddled with this unexpected guest. And subsequently, a little while later, or a day later, again, the time is one mass. I was taken to what used to be an SS hospital and sanatorium in Tutzing, in the city itself, or in the village itself, where by that time the wounded SS or recovering SS soldiers were sort of pushed out from the facilities, or the better part of the facilities, and the bullet was removed by an SS officer. It wasn't a deep wound, it was very superficial. Under the very close supervision of a couple of fellow prisoners or former prisoners who were standing near the operating table ready to kill the SS doctor if something happened to me. And then I was there for a couple of days dressed in the pajamas that these friends rustled up in the home of those two women. And when I felt strong enough, I picked myself up and walked in those pajamas towards Feldafing, which wasn't too far from there, which was by that time known as being what eventually were called a DP camp, where Jews began to be collected by the American soldiers. And there I became a member of the Committee of Seven that organized the DP camp and for all intents and purposes ran it for the American military government and worked in the American military government office as part of my duties as a member of the committee. And of course I volunteered my services to the Americans.
Philip?
Yeah.
Could we go back for a few moments to Auschwitz and the day that you arrived there? You heard from someone who you had once studied with.
In Switzerland.
In Switzerland. That your life and the lives of your friends and fellow inmates were in great peril.
It was more than that. I mean, the man had 4 years of concentration camp existence by then, and he was thoroughly worst in the concentration camp life and in the nature of the Holocaust, and he left absolutely nothing to the imagination.
Can you recall your thoughts at that time?
Can I recall my thoughts? What do you think somebody thinks when he's told that look up at the smoke and see, there goes your mother? You have no thoughts. You're devastated. And you are drained of all normal mental processes. Your mind doesn't function as the mind is accustomed to function. Your mind becomes a black hole. You can't disbelief and you can't believe. You can't fail to accept, but you can't realize it. Again, it was also part of the whole process of dehumanization. Perhaps this not planned by the Germans, because this was, as I say, a very unusual and fortuitous event. But the fact that that people could, even if only as rumor, hear, or even in they did not believe the odor or the sight of the smoke, but even if it was only a doubt that was gnawing away at your mind, it completely devastated your mental processes. You were not an ordinary human being on the planet Earth. You were mentally, certainly, a zombie on a different planet, maybe a little green man on Mars.
And what kept you going?
What kept me going? Me, you know, and people like myself, and the literature on the Holocaust is very clear on this. People who were aware and politically conscious had a better chance of mental survival than those who were not. Intellectuals and the intelligentsia may have had a diminished physical capacity or facility for survival than people, for instance, who were accustomed to heavy labor all through their life, or who were physically in better condition than the average intellectual would be. But on the other hand, intellectual who has had political consciousness and had a better chance of mentally surviving, and in a way become more useful to his fellow prisoners because of that. And there are ample examples and proofs of that.
Can you tell me a little bit about your life in Auschwitz for the few weeks that you were there?
Well, my life was that of the millions who were who went through Auschwitz. We were housed in a wooden barrack, sleeping on wooden pallets, with maybe 12, and eventually, as it became more crowded, and this would happen in every other camp, the physical setup was the same. They would pile in more than 12 or 15, where you literally couldn't move, and if you did move, the whole 15 had to move and readjust their position. At one end of the hall, there was a room where usually what they called the Blockältester, the elder of the block, and the capo would be housed, and where there was some administrative procedure maintained. And at the other end, there was a huge kettle or vat-like metal vat, which was played the role of a toilet. All night long, people would be marching to void, and where which added a pretty pungent odor to the barrack. In the winter, and I wasn't there in the winter, but in other camps, they would have one little tin oven, which sometimes was fired up, so it would provide the meat. But basically, you know, the heat was provided by the, however exhausted the living organism of the human beings who were pressed in T-leucine, for instance. I remember that shortly after we finished building the camp, which is what we had to do first before we even went down to the mines, they had halved the camp after we barely moved in and put women into the other half. So if we were 10 to a pallet, then we were 20 after that, so that there would be room for the women, who were also probably put 20 in a pallet, and which also had a kind of an, I'm sure, unintended result. You know, our seeing women and our seeing some of our women led a great many people to believe that, our women are alive. Not even many people realized that if they saw only young and more or less healthy looking women, that meant that the mothers and the children were gone. Quite the contrary, that gave them this misleading hope. And again, it's that primitive psychology, that elementary psychology, you know, that played on the emotions and the beliefs of people. I remember so clearly when the women arrived at Alahau, everybody was absolutely convinced that our women were alive. And you know, the camp life was obviously universally the same, with variations dependent on the camp commandant or on the location or on the climate, but basically it was the same system. I was in no way different in that sense than anybody else.
What was the food like in Auschwitz and the other camps?
Well, in Auschwitz, the people who were not in what they called labor camps, and there were some labor camps in Auschwitz too, people who were taken out to work in various installations, there would be only some black fluid. It certainly wasn't coffee, must have been chicory, sometimes a little more sweet, sometimes less sweet, in the morning. And in the evening, there would be a piece of bread, I think it was 20 grams, and some kind of slop that was called soup, which sometimes consisted of some potato peels or little pieces of some vegetable. You know, it's all a very complicated story, that like everything about the Holocaust. The bread, was obviously spiked in certainly in the later days with sawdust. The soups were really slop, and there was, in labor camps, there was supposed to have been at least some residue of meat in it, and you have to know that although Germany was a very orderly and well-organized country. Human systems are very imperfect, and there was plenty of corruption, particularly at that late stage in the war, for a whole variety of reasons, political and practical. But the most practical reason was that the Germans also were lacking quite a bit of everything, and so the SS were stealing the camps blind from whatever monies they were supplied with or they were collecting as payment. You know, we were hired out to other institutions and structures in the Nazi state. And they collected whatever they collected for us, and then they supposedly administered and operated the camps out of it, and they were stealing, as they were stealing from the food supplies that were destined for the prisoners. There is no way in which anything about the camps or the Holocaust can be adequately described. Let me really say this. I'm always bothered by the notion that, you know, the Holocaust is knowable or can be described. The Holocaust is going to be the longest untold story. There is no way in which the real truth of the Holocaust can be described, conveyed, or communicated to the world, to the outside world, that is, to those who were not there. It is not one story. It is the story of every survivor. And then there is the 6 million stories that will never be told, that cannot be told. This is quite apart from such prosaic matters as, you know, although surprising, and we keep being surprised at how much written documentation and material can be found about the concentration camp. I mean,
Philip, we're going to need to take a break.
Sorry?
We need to take a break.
Okay. Isn't it? Or I can give you a listing of the camps, and then you can ask about the liberation. By the time you get done with that, he'll be.
This is tape number 8, and I'm interviewing Philip Katz. Go ahead, Philip.
I believe I was in the middle of telling that the Holocaust story is going to be the longest untold story ever told, and I am quite convinced that that will be the case. You know, perhaps my own concentration camp career, you should forgive me for the expression, can be an illustration of one aspect of this inexpressibility of the camp. I mean, you take me, I was fundamentally incarcerated for exactly 1 year. In 1 year, I went through Auschwitz, I went through France in Thiel, Usigny. I went from there through the better part of Germany, through Kochendorf, Heilbronn am Neckar, Dachau, and finally Allach, and then was still presumably being transported to a place that was rumored to be Ötztal in Austria, where we were all supposed to have been either shot or drowned into a lake, or so that no trace of us would be left. And the things experienced, learned, and the things done or not done, felt and thought, would take my whole life. Not the years that I have left, but the years I have lived already to describe, and then I would not come nearly to the point where I will have adequately described what I had gone through. And this has really nothing to do with the whether or not I was beaten, or whether I was driven. It's the life of 1 year and the six camps is each moment of it was an eternity. Finally, as I said before, we were shuttled to the Stutzig and were liberated. And unlike, I suppose, 99% of the survivors, I had an address. When we were deported, we all, of course, etched into our heart and into our mind our father's sister's address, where he had lived, and we all agreed that whoever of us survives, is that is going to be the meeting place for us. And so when I grabbed the first American soldier and wrote and told him to advise my father that I'm alive, I would say that it took no more than maybe a week or 10 days when he returned to me, and incidentally, in honor of this soldier's private parent, who my sister and I have rediscovered maybe about 2 years ago and who has since died, I should say that he went about Germany buttonholing survivors and asking them whether they had relatives or friends or anybody that they wished to notify through him of their survival. This was his way of trying to help the survivors. Anyway, within about 7 to 10 days, he sought me out, I think still in the hospital in Tutzing, and brought back a letter from my father and two of my sisters, who wrote me with the, in their own handwriting. And this was an almost unbelievable occurrence. When survivors heard of it, again, the same kind of hope welled up in the minds of a lot of people. Listen, if Philip has three sisters already in America, well, only we were only liberated 10 days ago. it must be that a lot of, if not all, of women and families have survived.
What was the date that you were liberated?
I was liberated on VE Day, which officially was May 8. We were really, I think, liberated probably after the surrender was signed by Admiral Dönitz, a few hours after that. And then, as I started to say, I went to Feldafing and...
Philip, you were in the hospital in Tutzing.
Yeah.
You were there because you had been shot, you had tried to escape. Were you suffering from anything else? What was your general physical condition at that time?
Well, I was pretty well run down long before that, along about October or so. Of 1944, in other words, about 8-9 months into the camp period, I was so weakened, as many others were before me and after me, that I had begun to give up. It is, in fact, as a result of that, that I got to Dachau. I was sent to Dachau, what they called in German, Erholung, for recovery. Not many people would have, in their right mind, undertaken to volunteer to go. But I had reached the point, not physically, but emotionally and mentally, where I was at the verge of giving up. It was a very critical moment. For me, I have described that in detail at, in the Yale taping. I discovered one day when we were at most unusually at relative leisure in a camp, and I said to myself suddenly, "You bastard, today you didn't think of your mother and sisters." And that to me spelled the end of my humanity. And so I began to give up. Fortunately enough, apparently I still had enough mental reserves that with just a little bit of time in Dachau where I didn't have to work, and even though that maybe the food rations were smaller, at least I didn't have to work, and so maybe more of the calories stayed with me, and I began to recover. And then I was sent to Allach and got into the kitchen, which enabled me to have a little more food, and which enabled me also to bring some food out for others, including most particularly for our Salker Rebbe, who insisted on remaining kosher. And so I recovered, and I'm alive, and only because of that, because I had apparently enough emotional and psychological and mental reserves to preserve my humanity.
You had mentioned earlier, you had referred to the fact that you had thought of escaping on many occasions or had tried.
That has, you know, never ceased to be a preoccupation, a futile one most of the times for myself and several others who, like myself, were, what shall I say, aware and conscious people. On one occasion when we were being taken from Allach to from Tilusini to back to Germany, we were stopped at the station of Luxembourg, and we were in open cars, you know, coal cars, and there was an air raid, and the SS spread out in the fields around the rails. And a young man and myself, we wanted to make a break for it. Unfortunately, before we could finally manage to make a break for it, the air raid alarm was called off, and suddenly the SS was coming back, and it was too late. And again, you had this, this interplay of the time question. At in Tilusini, I am to this day convinced that the local underground and some of the other different kind of forced laborers who were not Jews, Poles and Czechs, etc., who were in the area, were, and particularly the French underground, were about ready to assist us if we made a move. And again, it was an interplay of the time that just didn't work on the one hand, and on the other hand, unfortunately, one of the leaders of our camp that we recognized as, as our leader translated the warning of the camp commandant that we shouldn't try anything word for word, saying that every second man would be shot out of the line, and of course we were all paralyzed. Who was going to take it upon himself to be responsible for having his fellow prisoner shot out from the line? So,
and this was in which camp?
This was in France, in Tilusini, just as we were being evacuated from there. And but you know, to some of us, the young, so to say, and the strong, and it mostly required mental and emotional strength besides just physical strength. The notion of attempting to escape was never too far. And, you know, we talked of it and we tried to figure out how it could be done, and by the time we would try to figure, we managed to figure out what we thought might be a good way of doing it, the opportunity disappeared.
Can you walk me through a typical day in one of these labor camps?
Well, he would be generally awakened during the time when it was still dark. Couldn't have been more than 4:30 or something like that. And we would have probably about 15 minutes or so to prepare ourselves, which in the case of some of us, unfortunately not all of us, meant that we would rush to this trough over which a pipe was dripping water, and we would wash ourselves to the best extent that we could, and of course go out to urinate or so. And then we would stand in line and we would get this black fluid that was considered coffee, and then we would be herded into the five in a row and marched out of the camp under SS guard, with it going through this village of Isigny, where on occasion apparently some Hungarian woman lived there. I don't know, must have been married or something like that. There would be children, women would stand along the street and throw us some food, and or children would run into the line, and before they were caught, and stick a piece of bread or something into our hands. And we would go through, incidentally, this is, you know, sounds like a heartwarming kind of story. The more important aspect of it is that this has happened in Germany, that is, that we were being marched through the cities and the states, and villages. And aside from all other facts of life, the German claim that they didn't know is on the face of it so false. I mean, As I have once said to many years ago to a German in Frankfurt, you didn't see me, but I saw you. And you can't tell me that you don't know about me.
Because you were so frequently marched.
Because we were marched through the cities and villages and towns.
And what would they have seen had they seen you, Philip? What condition?
All they had to see is the condition that we were in and the manner in which we were being treated, even just as we were being driven to work or back to the camp.
And what was this treatment like?
That was enough for anyone. I mean, the brutality with which we were driven in and out of camp was absolutely enough for anybody. I mean, butts of the carbines or whatever the heck they were carrying, and the shouting, and the dogs around us. And if somebody fell, they would right away start tearing us all apart, there was no way in which any civilian, German, even if he did not live in a town or a city where we were being driven across, but it's enough if you're driven across one town. There is no way in which word of that wouldn't have spread all through the country. As I say, this is quite independent of all the other things, like the soldiers writing home and coming home on furloughs and telling the stories and the photographs and the pictures and the films and all sorts of other things. I'm just taking this one little elementary fact of life. We were visible. And the Germans could and did see us, but they really didn't see us for a completely different reason. We were, after all, not human beings. We were, by their definition, Untermensch. And they were the Übermensch. And even those who perhaps were not imprisoned in the Nazi ideology, not only they closed their eyes because it was better not to see and not to know, but we really didn't count. And by the way, this is quite mutual. I mean, to me, a German SS man was also not human. He was an SS man. He was a Nazi. He was a killer. He was a murderer. He was not a human being. Not someone that I, with the rarest exception, that I would relate even in my mind as to a human being. It's very important that we realize how this can happen to human being, that they are dehumanized not only in fact but in each other's eyes and consciousness.
Philip, the villagers at times would throw food at
that
at
was
you
in France.
Why were they doing that?
What in France?
What were they seeing that provoked them
in
to
France,
give you
there
food?
Was. There was a resistance, and they were oppressed by the Germans, and felt oppressed by the Germans. Certainly, there was a kind of commiseration, so to say.
Were they concerned that you weren't being fed adequately? Is that why they were also?
Well, they could see it. All you had to do was to look at us. We were walking skeletons. Even though that I was in T. Lucigny, maybe for about 3 months or so. So it was three months of after arriving in Auschwitz. All you had to do was to look at us and you would see what condition we were in, and again in that particular case, they were passing by, people were passing by on the road, our camp was in a little valley, and the road was in a little elevation, and they could see the camp, and they could see what was happening.
So they saw prisoners who were starving and prisoners who were being beaten?
They recognized that they must have been starving because of the way they appeared, and they looked. A lot of people, of course, were also aware of the fact that the Germans themselves didn't have too much.
How did you cope with your own hunger?
People will probably never be able to quite recognize what hunger can do to you. Hunger is not a desire to eat. Hunger is something that breaks down your being, your identity, and your humanness. When everything else in the world ceases to exist, the only thing that you feel and that you're aware of is that terrible pain, that urge, that unbelievable desire to stuff something into your mouth. You become, virtually like a single-celled animal that wants to put the food in one end and let it come out on the other end, and nothing else exists but that one single function. Hunger, you can't imagine what it does to human beings. It's not just starvation or famine. It destroys your human identity. As I said, nothing exists either in reality or emotionally or mentally except that pain, urge, readiness to fall upon anything that you can put into your mouth.
How did the guards generally treat you and the inmates you were with?
I don't know whether or not my case, or for that matter, the case of the camps that I was in, is typical at all or in any way, worse or than in other places. It was in other places. You have to remember that we were a relatively valued group. We were hired out originally to Organisation Todt, which was responsible for the manufacturing, to the Air Force, and so we had an Air Force group that was supervising us, and they were by no means, many of them, as bad as the SS. In the first place, they don't consider themselves guards. They were guarding the interests of the Air Force and of getting the fuselages done. The SS would be beyond the perimeter of the camp, usually. They guarded the camp. But once we went to work and we were put down into the mine, there were maybe one or two SS men around, but we were basically working under Air Force and Organisation Todt supervision. So, except for the occasions when somebody was caught supposedly in sabotage because it was screwing in a light and it burst. In other words, he was really not sabotaging. But they spent a week literally tearing him in bits and pieces.
And did you ever see that happening?
Sure. They erected a special tent who had a torture team, and they would not let him die for a whole week. And all week long, this horrible, inhuman shriek and cry was emanating from that tent. It was the most horrible experience, and with it went our impotence, our inability to do anything for him or about him. And then again, we tried to figure out how we could somehow manage to get some food to him or something, or even a knife so he could kill himself. And it just...
In which camp did this
happen? Doesn't work. This was in Kochendorf, I think.
And do you recall the name of the prisoner?
No, I recall that he was a tinsmith in our town. Mm-hmm. I don't remember his name.
Do you recall the names of the guards?
By the way, no. The guards didn't have names. This brings me back to this business of us not being humans. I mean, we were, at best, a number. So, we even forgot our own names. Certainly the names of our fellows, There were some of us, who managed to more or less stay together at one point or another for one time or another, but there could be no permanence to any kind of relationship. There couldn't be any real continuity.
What were the working conditions like generally in the camps?
Well, the working day more or less was 12 hours plus the time of going and coming, which probably, if you add it all up, wound up between 15 to 17 hours. You would get 3-4 hours sleep at most. The working conditions in the mines, certainly in France, weren't so bad, in particular because there were about 500,000 forced laborers of all kinds within the vicinity, and the sabotage was rampant. I mean, the lights would go out suddenly in the mine, and everything would halt. We were not. That terribly badly treated, exceptionally from beyond the rules of what was going on in the camps. At times, it depended on particular times.
Philip, we're going to take a break.
Sure.